We're streaming? Oh, we're streaming. All right, so the only announcement I got for MySec is we have Converge and B-Sides kind of being announced. So our dates for that are going to be July 14th, 15th, and 16th. If you're interested in helping out, volunteering, all those things, come talk to me.
Interesting.
Yeah, and give me your info. I'll take it down. We can get you going. We'll have some interesting opportunities for growth. Otherwise, yeah. Otherwise, I'll hand it over to Mark.
Do I need to be anywhere around this volume?
The speakers.
There.
Speakers.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Perfect. So you can hold this and walk around?
Yeah. All right. So I'll stand pretty close to you then.
Yeah.
It'll be able to pick you up if you move around.
Okay. Cool. Is this on too? Wow. We got a lot of microphones going on.
I don't need.
Maybe
this
kill
one.
That one.
And kill.
That got exciting quick. Cool. Well, hello, MySec Jackson, and hello, internet somewhere. So I'm Mark Stanislav. I work over at Rapid7. Hopefully some of you ran into me at a conference once or twice over the years. So today's talk is about research that I did kind of from roughly like March of this year all the way through about July. So it's pretty long run of research. Reason being is that we went over 9 devices total. So we have 9 devices, and when we're talking about IoT devices, right, we have the hardware itself, you have mobile apps, cloud services, backend services, web apps, like it just expands very quickly. So 9 devices times like a dozen individual research projects per device, right? Because each one is its own little thing that you have to kind of dive into, look for bugs and assess. So spins out of control very quickly. I would not recommend doing 9 devices ever. Pick one at a time and go crazy like that. So if I like that we were talking about CSI Cyber briefly at the start. So March 6th, so just after I had purchased all these devices to do this research, CSI Cyber has episode number 1. I've still never seen it. I was told by multiple people, of course, that knew I was going to do this research, that CSI Cyber like made their first plot effectively my research. So I guess there was some Hacking Babe monitor thing or something. Dave Vitale, if you don't know Dave, he Daily Dave mailing list, been around for a long time. You know, he has this whole opinion on junk hacking. So doing research for projects that don't have what he considers a valuable kind of outcome. So he has this whole perspective and kind of poking fun at CSI Cyber and Babe monitors as a means to look at any topic that show would do is so ridiculous that clearly it's not good research, which of course is my research project we're talking about. And then my PR director, Jen Ellis, who you might have also ran into at many conferences over the years, Jen sent me this thing immediately after, kind of tongue-in-cheek apologizing, but also probably sincerely apologizing that they ruined this topic. So we'll, you know, clearly we have, you know, some funny screenshots, but realistically, right, if you have a child yourself, if you have a niece or a nephew, if you're planning to have kids at some point in your life, you probably will at some point own a baby monitor. And much like TVs, right, you can almost not get a TV without internet connectivity. You can't get a Wi-Fi, you know, a Blu-ray player, a DVD player, you know, everything has Ethernet or Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, right? So realistically, we're seeing a transition in the market space of baby monitors, where right now, your kind of like stock typical RF baby monitor is still the golden standard. If you go to a store right now, you're more likely to find a lot of just like RF-based baby monitors than internet-connected ones. Now, this is, of course, shifting, and we're seeing the transition, but it's still pretty impressive how well RF has held on while everything else has switched so quickly to internet. In fact, if you look at Amazon, which we'll see some info here in a bit, Amazon, if you look at all the baby monitors in the category, sort them by popularity, the first 29 are actually RF-only baby monitors. So it's not till the 30th result in sales rank for Google that you actually get to an internet-connected baby monitor. So we're actually at the start of this. Despite that, there are dozens and dozens of these cameras on the market, and we'll talk about price points and other stuff like that. Funny one up here being on the right side of the screen, that's an actual screenshot from a text my mother-in-law sent me. She was going to a baby shower, she was buying a gift, and she links me to this thing like, oh, is it, you know, is it safe? And she's kind of funny, so she wrote Scallywags. So she sent me this link. I'm like, oh yeah, I'll check it out, look at it. And this monitor in her actual message is the one that we'll talk about at the very end of this talk, with the easiest, worst vulnerability of all the cameras. So I told her, no, don't buy that, and buy an RF1 and probably be safer. But we hear these stories all the time, right? This is nothing new, whether it's an RF-based one that maybe just doesn't have a ton of, like, you know, frequency hopping spread spectrum, or, you know, you've got some creepy neighbor next to you that's intercepting your RF and, like, doing weird things. That happens, but realistically, if you have one vulnerability or know how to compromise, you know, with, like, software-defined radio, like one camera, you still have a proximity thing, right? You have to be somewhat close by to do it. When we're talking internet-connected cameras, you have one vulnerability, you have thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of cameras, right? So we have a much larger impact with one vulnerability than just, you know, an RF camera getting, you know, one jerk at a time. This is all the cameras at one time. A lot of the cameras on the market today, the you know, typical RF ones you might see, are, I think one of the reasons they're holding on to market share is overall they actually have a lot of features. Like, they have a lot of the features you want. So beautiful, like, big color, you know, LCD screens, you know, functionality like playing like lullaby songs from the camera built in, or you know, moving the camera around with control pad that you can get. All this can be done just via RF. So most of the features that people want on average are going to be built into cameras that you know, don't necessarily have the internet risks. The only downside are things like, maybe like the last bullet point's a really good example. So I actually have a kid on the way in January, first kid. So if I wake up 4 a.m. and my kid's screaming in their crib or something and I can hear them, this camera, I can, it'll you know, take a 30-second video and audio clip. And from the time the kid starts screaming, it takes like 15 seconds before it happens and 15 seconds after it happens. And so I can go, oh, like, why are they screaming? Did they just wake up and maybe they'll go back to bed? Or did they wake up, walk around, and like fall and like hit their head on the crib? I don't know. I wasn't there. I couldn't tell what happened. So there's a really good value there to having some replayability other than live streaming. So that's one kind of useful benefit. Another one, of course, I travel a lot. Luckily, that'll be slowing down as well on the baby on the way. But if I want to see my camera remotely, you can only do that with an internet-connected camera. You can't do that with RF. So if my wife's at home and I'm on a long trip and I'm in Korea or something like where I got this hoodie, I want to see my kid and I want to see my wife and make sure everything's okay. You can't do that with an RF one. So while we have a lot of good features in normal RF, there are reasons to, of course, still get an internet-connected one. And plus, everyone likes internet-connected stuff. Everyone wants an app to do everything right now. So it's another reason. Babe monitors, and what I want to point out is I've done IoT research for a number of years now. I work with a lot of IoT vendors, both in research capacities and professionally at Rapid7. This is a really good case study of babe monitor security, but all of these things apply 100% to just about every other IoT device I look at. And IoT devices, not just for consumers, but also business IoT, so M2M IoT solutions. So while, you know, we have a very specific context here, what you'll hear about and learn about today is very much applicable to the general, you know, Internet of Things and what we're seeing in the market. The biggest problem with IoT right now is supply chain, and that supply chain of hardware, software, services, everything. Because what really happens with IoT is very few vendors that you buy a product from are actually the people making the stuff in that product. Now, that's always been the case with a lot of different technologies. However, when you have an internet-connected camera, you have the hardware that's, you know, the camera itself. You've got the firmware, which very often comes directly from the ODM, the original design manufacturer, just from them. It could be 10 years out of date, 5 years out of date. You get all the third-party chipsets like Bluetooth and Wi-Fi. And then you add on all the services to do stuff. How do you take a video stream with Wi-Fi and live encode it so that you can view it on your phone? Who's providing the intermediary service between that? Who's doing the bandwidth? Who's doing the cloud hosting for the video clips that you record those 30-second segments on? So each of these things have their own need to solve, and very few vendors are going to build their own solutions for all these things. They're gonna trust third parties to do it for them. They're gonna take solutions that are pre-baked. They're gonna take services that are already in existence and then pretty much glue them all together and bolt them on. And as many of you know, the whole concept of bolt-on security always is gonna be a failure, and that's very, very, very true in IoT right now. The so you know, you see that bullet point list, mobile apps and cloud and all that stuff. You know, that's kind of a short list, but each of these things, each of these areas of technology, pretty much no vendor is going to be an expert in every one of them. And even if you hire third-party service providers, they're probably not going to be experts in all of them. So what happens is maybe you get a really good engineer at wireless protocols, or you get a really good engineer at hardware design, or a web app developer. But the odds that that web app developer is also proficient enough to look at the work that some third-party mobile vendor that you hire to do the mobile app for your product is actually secure and you know, efficient at security controls and active. So somewhere in the entire ecosystem of this IoT device, there's going to be a bug. There's going to be a vulnerability. There's going to be something to attack. And when you're going through a research project like this, you can very quickly tell not only maybe who made the stuff, because sometimes you see vendors, you know, they'll put a copyright date in code they wrote and then copied and pasted for different clients, and it's their code still, and you know who wrote it. Sometimes I'll dump firmware, and the firmware build strings will actually have the person's actual email address for the third party that built the firmware. So then now I know who the original firmware vendor was. So you start finding these like breadcrumbs, and you start uncovering where all these components got sourced from, who built them, how old they are, and it becomes very interesting. So it's very hard for a single vendor to have all the proficiency and security that they need to make an actually secure device. The last thing in this, you know, kind of evolution that we're facing right now with IoT is whether it's frameworks or protocols, standards, guidance, all this stuff is very much in the air. There's very little concrete, and for those of you that have been in IT a while and kind of remembered, I'm trying to think, what were you going to go with? 10 years ago, let's say, when cloud computing started being a thing, and everyone's like, oh, we've done cloud computing before, or like, it's no big thing, it's nothing new, we know how this works. You should treat IoT like that, because for half, you know, let's say 5 years of that, from 10 years till halfway, people were still fighting and like swimming upstream and be like, cloud computing's not a thing, it's not, you know, blah, blah, blah. And meanwhile, all the people that got in early were building standards, building frameworks, building APIs, building all the structure that today, when we see Amazon Web Services with like their 70 services they offer, and Microsoft Azure and on and on and on, we're like, yeah, cloud computing's a thing, no shit. We're at the IoT part where everyone's like, oh, IoT, we know what this is, we've done this before. And so there's a whole group of people that are, again, swimming against the stream and not wanting to actually like solve problems. So we have companies like Google doing a lot. We have the Online Trust Alliance building a trust framework. We have an initiative that I co-founded called Build Securely, which we'll talk about. So there are efforts, but it's early days, right? Like, we're in the nascency of a lot of this, and it's gonna take a while to figure out like which way's up. So one thing that I really hate about a lot of technical talks is no one talks about how to do the work. Everyone just talks about how cool the results are. So if you're looking to get into like hardware hacking, IoT hacking, or just generally you want to know more about offensive security research, here's some cool things that we'll talk about briefly. So one thing that I've heard in way too many talks is people go, oh yeah, you can totally get the firmware off of the flash chips inside devices. Completely true. You absolutely can do that. But what a lot of people start their talk with is like, okay, so you get your like desoldering kit, and you get this, and you get this, and you get solder sucker, and you heat it up, and you take this. So a lot of people spend a lot of time taking chips off of devices to then extract data off of them. You do not have to do that in many, many, many cases. Very often, the simplest case and example being the Pomona SOIC clip. So SOIC just stands for Small Outline Integrated Circuit, and that's usually the package you'll see flash chips in very often, for especially embedded hardware. And you don't need to desolder these chips to get the information off them. You can literally just hook up a little clip, attach some leads over to a bus pirate or a Shikra or one of other many other devices that talk this serial peripheral interface, which is SPI for short. And SPI is basically the communication channel that serial chips, in this case a SOIC package, talks over. So you hook up a clip, hook it up to a bus pirate or Shikra or whatever, you run one little command in flash ROM, it knows how to speak SPI, it takes the data off. You then get something like binwalk, which will literally just like carve up a binary or, you know, whatever it has in front of it and go, oh, that's a JPEG. Oh, that's an ELF you know, executable. Oh, that's a file system. It'll carve it up for you and take all this data out and be like, here's your file system. You know, here's your Etsy shadow file, go crazy. So to get started in any of this like hardware stuff, the number one thing that you're gonna wanna do for many reasons is open the device up and start looking for flash chips. That should be your first goal. And it's very easy to spot these things. They all look pretty much the same, the size is the same. Most of them are stamped pretty well with a model part, you know, part number, so you can look them up. But once you get it, you have access to the whole file system. And why that's important, of course, is now you have access to the binaries, so you can start reverse engineering those. You have access to config files, and very often config files will have content that the vendor never expected you to see, and you start finding out cool things. Or you get a shadow file, and as many of you probably do, you know, run hashcat or whatever you want to do, crack password hashes, and very often in embedded hardware you will have hard-coded passwords. You'll have basically effectively backdoor root credentials, backdoor unprivileged user credentials, and you start getting these passwords out, and guess what? Now you can compromise devices remotely if you can get a remote access service. And very often, I would say actually almost entirely, if there is a Unix credential, I would almost guarantee it will be hard-coded. I've seen one out of dozens and dozens of IoT devices that actually generated passwords on a like Unix-like file system. So once you get it, you're pretty much golden. The other thing you have is, because a lot of these things are using cloud services, you get vendors like the screenshot there that start accidentally getting their data indexed onto Google. And in this case, this was actually a real user's account data being indexed by Google. And because I was reverse engineering the mobile app, I knew, oh, this API endpoint's really interesting. I should look on Google and see if anything's on Google for it. Unless you know there's a host name to look for, you might not see it or you might not look for it. So that's a very quick way that you can start extracting little bits of data from a binary or, you know, firmware or whatever, and then start applying it to go outside of the bounds of the software, but actually to like cloud services and see interesting things. UART is effectively what you're going to be working with if you do a serial console in modern embedded hardware. It's just a signaling protocol. And so you can do this a lot of ways. They make little USB cables that have just like, you know, enough wires, like, so you have you transmit, you receive, your ground and voltage usually. And you hook these wires up, you get a serial console like you probably are all used to some degree. And the cool thing about when you have a serial console is, one, for instance, all the 9 of the devices we're talking about tonight, all of them had a UART that I could connect to, all of them, everyone. So 9 out of 9 is a pretty good hit rate on UART, so you're pretty guaranteed to see one in real life if you get your own project going. Sometimes they drop you to a root shell, so you just hook up TXRX and ground, and you get a root shell, and you're just on the device's root. That's cool, because you can just do whatever you want and start, you know, going crazy. 8 out of 9 of these things, I think, ran U-boot. U-boot's like the bootloader of choice in embedded hardware these days. And U-boot's cool, one, because you have, generally speaking, there are some people that shut you down, but you generally have full privilege over kernel boot arguments. So if a lot of you are probably somewhat familiar with Linux, and you drop to single user mode, you can single user mode get into a system that has a password, change the password, and now you're booting into a fully privileged, you know, environment as root. So you have bootloader configuration options for the most part when you have U-boot, and can do cool stuff like bypassing passwords altogether. JTAG is this really kind of gray area for most people. So JTAG, it's effectively a means of communication that doesn't really have parameters around what it's communicating. So it's just a way to basically put on a shift register bits of data, and then the hardware does stuff with it. And how you define it is mostly obscure or abstracted through things like OpenOCD, URJTAG, these different software components that know how to talk to the device you're talking to. The thing about JTAG though is you're speaking at probably the lowest level you'll ever talk to hardware via some like third-party interface. So when you talk to a microcontroller, you are just spinning data into this microcontroller as if you're literally on the bus, right? You have all the control in the world, you just have to kind of know what you want to do with it. And so two good examples of what you can do with JTAG, and this isn't a global thing, but pretty close to it for most embedded stuff, is one, and probably the most easy and useful thing, is just dumping memory. So you get on a device, you don't have a password, for some reason you can't single user mode, you know, take your context of what goes wrong. And you're like, oh, maybe there's some cool stuff. Maybe I could see a password in memory. Maybe I could see HTTP endpoints. Maybe I could see session keys. who knows what's in memory, right? Like we saw what Heartbleed happened, right? Heartbleed was awesome. You just got random bytes of memory. Imagine being able to do not random bytes of memory, but literally all of the memory on a device you're trying to hack, right? You have a lot of intelligence there that you can grab. So you can literally just do live memory dumps via JTAG directly to GDB and start looking at memory. The other thing, because you have memory access, is let's say there is actually hard-coded kernel parameters, so they prevent you from doing single-user mode or other ways that you want to get around a kind of boot protection. Well, if you know what to look for, you can actually look through the memory and find where the kernel parameters are. Once you see that string and get that memory address, you just add a hex 20 and then hex 1, and guess what? You just added single user mode to that hard-coded kernel parameters. So you've actually changed live memory during execution via a couple wires into this board. Like crazy stuff that you would never think you could even do, but such a valuable thing if you're trying to hardware hack, because realistically getting into the hardware is like step one. After you get into the hardware, you're looking for stuff to reverse and looking at stuff like vulnerabilities and hard-coded credentials. So you want to get into the hardware as quick as possible. You don't want to spend all your time on that. Mobile apps is a huge, huge, huge area of IoT success when it comes to research. And the reason why, especially with Android apps, is when developers develop apps, they think, oh, I'm writing code, it's compiling, and what's compiled is unreadable. You know, it's a binary now, right? And so whether you're iOS or you're Android, more so Android, you know, you can run a simple tool like dex2jar, and you take all the dex that was compiled, it creates effectively, for the most part, pretty damn good readable Java, and now you're looking at Java source code. And you literally can just step through this Java source code, like method by method, and see what's inside that mobile app. And so we get things like, we get hard-coded URLs to where firmware is downloaded from, for instance. You get things like API keys for different APIs, or using like Amazon S3, for instance, happens a lot. And you have maybe hard-coded passwords that it's looking for, or flags that you can enable and get a debug mode inside the mobile app. There's all kinds of crazy shit that happens, and just by looking through some Java, you can very quickly find a lot of this. With iOS, it's a little bit harder because they do encrypt the binary. Decrypting the binary, all you need is a jailbroken iOS device. You can decrypt binary. After that, it's still a binary. You can't really get readable, Objective-C back out, really. You can do things like look at strings and, you know, put it through like a hex editor and find some stuff. But if you can find an Android app for the IoT device you're hacking on, you know, go with that. API calls shouldn't be a shock, right? A lot of the stuff that we see is still not using SSL or TLS. So just, and even if it is, for the most part, they're not going to be doing certificate pinning. So you just man the middle of the traffic, give it a bad cert that sits in the middle with like minimum proxy or put it into burp suite or something else, and start looking at traffic live. And usually why that's important is because developers have a habit of thinking that if they don't show it to you, it doesn't exist, right? And so they do things on the back end that they would never tell you they're doing if you could see it in your browser. And so we had this whole new era of developers kind of like cognitive dissonance where there's just like, oh, well, I'm not showing the end user this in the GUI, therefore they don't know it exists. That's happened more and more and more times than I can tell you in research. And it's amazing when you find something fun. Basic stuff, Wireshark and Map, right? You want to know what ports it has. Some IoT devices actually have no listening ports. Some devices are literally only communicate outbound. They don't have any ports that they listen on, which is good. You ideally shouldn't, in a properly deployed IoT device, you shouldn't have any ports. Then, of course, Wireshark comes in, and you start seeing what's going over the wire either way. So, you know, hit and miss. Services, we got cloud, we've got backend, cloud services, of course, we'll talk about a little bit more in depth. And then many of these, especially cameras, for some reason, I don't know necessarily why, I think it's against supply chain. A lot of these cameras have a full admin web interface. It's not documented, consumers don't know it's there, you have no credentials to log into it, but it's there. And usually why is because it's some like off-the-shelf software that someone built. And then the mobile app that you're using to talk to this camera, all it's doing is just hitting this web server. So it's like a lazy man's API. It's just, oh, we have a web server backend, we have web server functionality, make a mobile app to send, you know, put and get and post requests, and you have an API, right? And that happens very often and kind of disconcertingly often. So the baby monitors. You know, when I said case study, I kind of tried meaning it as much as possible, which is to say, you know, you've got devices that are $55 all the way up to $260. You've got varied feature sets. You've got 8 vendors with 9 different devices. So why I feel so confident, aside from other stuff I do, to tell you like, oh, this is kind of a microcosm of what IoT looks like, is because let's say that I've never looked at another IoT device in my entire life. When you have 8 different vendors, you've seen what the industry looks like, right? These vendors are not like all like parent subsidiary companies, right? These are 8 different vendors, right? So anything that's happening is just how things work. It's how people do stuff. And as we'll see later, things aren't going so well in IoT. So there's a whole white paper. There's a webinar we've done a couple times at Rapid7 for this research. There's tons of news on it, luckily. So there's stuff that I'm going to talk about today that wasn't in the like white paper and stuff, and there's stuff in here or in the white paper that's not here. So if you want to know more, I could point you at the white paper as well. So this talk is kind of a ramp up. There are things in here that are not vulnerabilities, absolutely not vulnerabilities, but they're hilarious. So we're going to talk about them because it's valuable knowledge to know the kinds of things you can find and look for while you're doing research like this. And as we get to the tail end, we're going to ramp up to the critical vulnerabilities that some people have very bad days for. So first one being, there's something that a lot of people don't put enough thought into, which is that when you have IoT device, when you have any embedded hardware, when you don't have a consumer electronic, you're beholden to a user interface that's not the device itself, right? Like you pull out your phone, you're looking at your phone, it's a consumer electronic, you're interacting like that. You have to trust that what the mobile applications tell you is what's happening. You have no other way as an average consumer to know any different, right? And so this is a great example and just like such a perfect IoT's, your assumptions of IoT may not be as you would hope. And so this camera, not actually very few actually have this feature, but this camera specifically has a mode to disable baby monitoring. It's a little flick and you disable baby monitoring, it says it right there, right? Unfortunately, that's not true. It's actually not disabled. It's still streaming live data the whole time. What it's not doing is showing it on your screen. And therefore, it doesn't exist, right? And so this is an example where if you were manning the million, the traffic, which if you can't tell, it's just RTSP, which by default, RTSP proper has no encryption. So this is going over the wire unencrypted, not to mention the actual protocol establishment, everything else. That whole URL, you just copy and paste it in VLC and you're viewing video live. So you've got this stream. Let's say you're attacking this person's network, you're on the network, you're viewing the baby monitor, and they're like, oh, like, whatever reason, we're gonna turn this baby monitor off for an hour, half hour, whatever you need. And so you get in this situation where the attacker's on your network, you've disabled baby monitoring, you think the camera's off, and it's still streaming, right? Such a good example of where this separation between a user's assumption and the reality of what a device is doing happens. And that's why when you hear these stories like, you know, smart TVs, like the Samsung smart TV listening all the time, people go, yeah, it's listening all the time, but so what? Well, this kind of stuff, right? Like, it's kind of a problem. Depends on who's listening on the other side when you think it's not. Kind of a weird example. If you're not much of a developer, this might be a little hard to follow, but I'll try to step through it real quick. So the top screenshot, when you're looking in reverse engineering code, of course, you're looking for things to reverse engineer and like look at and actually like get value from. And so there was a method called MD5 root session, which is such an awesome, terrible name for a method. And you're like, okay, I've got root session, I've got MD5, there's some value here. You can see that it says return MD5 hash, it's got an email address for the company that makes this product. You're like, this is pretty cool. Like whatever this is doing, I wanna know more about. And so you see where it's doing the string builder, that, you know, the line just above the MD5 hash line. And at the very like kind of end or halfway, you see append mchunk 99, append mchunk 60,000, blah, blah, blah. And so I look through the code and I find an mchunk method. I'm like, okay, what the hell is this thing doing? And I'm like, okay, so it takes in the number in the method, it passes it to the for loop, it does some math, it hits conditional, and eventually there's some equilibrium where it stops doing math. And it's like, okay, I'm done. And then that gets appended into the string. Basically what's happening here is they were in some way, shape, or form trying to like obfuscate what was actually the value going into this MD5 hash. Because whatever in that MD5 hash is being used for authentication to their web service. So they think they're being very clever. What happens though, where it gets really weird, is just after the for loop, you see that return statement. All of this code below that return statement is not even being hit. So all it's doing is just taking, what is it, FF, appending the number, and that's all it's appending. So you can literally do in your head what is up there just by looking at the rest. Well, maybe not the value of the hex number, but you can do the rest of it in your head and figure out what this string is. So why this happens, who knows? Maybe it was a bug. Maybe they were testing something and they gave up on it. Maybe they had a return statement to debug and forgot to take it out. And maybe they think this whole method's being hit the way it's supposed to be hit. Who knows? But this is only kind of stuff you ever know about, see, or learn by looking at code. You cannot see this on the wire. It won't make any sense on the wire. This is something you have to actually reverse engineer and look into. Wi-Fi baby, overall, Wi-Fi baby is like web interface. All the methods were, there was authentication, all the like web URL methods and all this good stuff. I was like, cool, that's great. But then the one thing that's exposed is log file. And this device specifically is UPnP, so it's going to be exposed on the internet directly with a port and have a dying DNS address that points at it all the time. So what happens when you have situations like this is you get things like this log file, and these things sometimes get indexed to Google, and then we can start doing things like looking on Google for stuff like this. And you know, some subtle details, I didn't really take much of a snippet here, but you know, you can see RTMP stream data information, which could be valuable. It's a log file. There could be credentials that get dumped out. There could be debug history that gets dumped out. You never know it's going to fall into a log file like this, even when you think you know. You know, internal IP space, right? All kinds of information that might be valuable to an attacker. So they spent all this time protecting the web interface, and then they dump out all this super like useful information to an attacker onto the internet. Second thing is, and you'll see this more and more during this talk, there's a huge lack of transport security. There's no data at rest security. Don't think for a second like anything on that camera is encrypted. It's not. But transit security, you know, 2015, we kind of assume SSL or TLS is being used, probably. With IoT right now, that's not the case. And so here's an example where the device itself supports SSL. There's an SSL cert with a hard-coded private key, so it's terrible implementation, but it's there. But it's not even used. So they have the feature, they have the functionality, they have the certain private key, and it's not even being used. And this is something that we'll see more of in a second. This specific camera, I think, was the most expensive at $260. The model number itself literally has 2015 in the model name. So there's no ambiguity of whether or not this device is old or new or whatever. If any of you remember these bugs or do pen testing, you'll definitely know these bugs. These two CVEs are two of the most critical and interesting bugs in the last few years, and they're remote code execution bugs on UPnP, Rapid7 before I got to Rapid7, HD Moore's team did a lot of research around this. These bugs are like as critical of bugs as you can get. This is like instant shell, basically, in terms of bugs. And it affected like millions of devices on the internet, so it was really, really good bugs. Now keep in mind, back to the supply chain problem, we have a brand new device, bought off the shelf, 2015 model, with two CVSS-10, as critical as you can get, internet-facing remote code execution bugs from 2012 in a $260 2015 device. This is the Internet of Things. This is what the reality of IoT is right now. You cannot pay to get security right now, because if you could, this device would not have those bugs. So huge problem, huge criticality, just terrible situation. And again, these cameras are directly exposed to the internet with a bug that can be directly owned via the internet. Lens peak of view, this is the cheap camera if you couldn't tell by how terrible everything looks with it. This one's kind of, again, more funny than anything. Again, doing packet captures, you see weird stuff. One of the things I saw with this one, it actually had FTP. I was like, why do you have FTP? That's super weird. And sometimes vendors will do FTP to do firmware. They might get firmware off FTP, which honestly is not that big of a deal as long as the firmware is signed. If it's signed and you actually have a PKI established, you can validate the integrity of the firmware. Like over FTP, clear text is fine. In this case, it wasn't used for that. All it was used for was to upload this email config file that effectively, from what I could tell, does nothing. The file had no content, and nothing in the user interfaces that they provide you gave you control to change this file that I could tell. So it just exists. But it was a unique account for my specific camera, and an FTP account within their server. So this is one of those weird things where, hey, you have an FTP account with arbitrary read-write access, you have your own WAR server now, whatever you want to do, right? Who needs BitTorrent? You can just upload stuff here and share it with people because you're using their bandwidth, their storage, and go crazy. So another one of those things where the people that made this camera assume you will never, ever, ever know this exists, right? Because who's looking at network traffic? That would be weird. This is another device that has a hidden web interface that you don't know about as a consumer. It's there, it does stuff, and it's whatever. Luckily, the admin at the top, you can actually change the admin password, so that's good. You can change the admin password. I don't think it forces you to, but you can. But you can't change the user, and guest logins. Nor do you know that they're there. You are never told that they are there. There is no user interface in which to change them. You have no access to change them. By definition, they are hard-coded credentials at this point. And unfortunately, they're not just like dummy accounts. They're not useless accounts. If you look at this, of course, unencrypted URL, this is actually doing a live stream with one of the many web service functions using the user credentials. So it's not like they're just dummy accounts and they have no purpose. You actually have privilege with them. Now, keep in mind that if you're on the network with the person with this camera in general, if it's not over the internet, there's no SSL, so you can just man middle the traffic and figure out what the password is anyways. So not a lot of safe assurances there. The camera itself has this crappy password, the 2601HX, of course, hard-coded password. This specific device only has one account, or I should say, this device has an account as admin. How it's set up on the privileges, it's basically world readable writable, so you basically have root as admin. It's just a bad file system deployment. So you can literally change the root password as an admin user. It's very awesome. I still don't know how to pronounce this camera, Ganyoi, I don't know. In terms of what we were talking about, how bad they're, the lack of SSL and TLS is, these are four different things. You've got two cloud services at the bottom, you've got a vendor themselves provided service, taking log data via like Base64 encoding, I didn't even bother. It says JSON up there, but I'm pretty sure it was actually Base64 in the blob, so figure that one out. You've got the service that actually streams live video over the internet, that's unencrypted. You've got the web interface that's on the back of the camera that you didn't even know was there, and then you've got another back-end camera service to do some basic negotiation stuff. So one device, two local services, two cloud services, nothing's encrypted. Trendnet. Trendnet's couple of minor things, relatively speaking, versus some of the other. And I should clarify that what we're talking about tonight is not every bug, not every vulnerability, not every backdoor credentials. I'm more interested in kind of showing you a broad swath of like reality than just like going over the same thing over and over. All these cameras suck, this TLDR. So this is an example where not only does the Trendnet web service in which you can like go on and live stream, is it completely unencrypted and your credentials go over unencrypted, but there's a cross-site scripting vulnerability in the service that lets you log in. So if you were so inclined, you can do like DOM manipulation and clickjack someone or like post a form on top or take your pick of like DOM-related ownage via cross-site scripting. All those things are alive and well. Obviously, you do not have HTTP only on cookies, so that's a whole other problem. Good example of things happening is they used to have Telnet enabled on this device, and they disabled it. And if you think Telnet, oh, haha, Telnet, just wait a second, you'll see more. So they disabled Telnet, good for them, Telnet's disabled, great. The problem is, if you are ever in charge of or talking to a vendor, if they have a binary, especially a service, especially a remote access service on the device and they aren't using it, tell them to get rid of it. Like, don't leave it around, because what happens is you find a vulnerability in some like bash script. You find a vulnerability, and bash is used all over cameras like this, via web interfaces, I mean. You find some stupid little bug, and all of a sudden you are now executing binaries. And if you can execute Telnet, well, guess what? You have remote shell access now. And that becomes a huge problem when you have a username of root and an admin password, or password of admin, and it's hard-coded on the device. And when I first talked to Trendnet, they're like, because I tested this before I did like looked into the Telnet part. I tested it via UART. I hooked up wires and like tested it via UART. And the response I got back from Trendnet was like, oh, there's not UART on there. I was like, yeah, there definitely is UART on here. I'm literally talking to it. And there could have been miscommunication. I'm not gonna like belabor that too much, but Like, they literally didn't think that there was access that I was abusing on the device. And again, supply chain problems. They might not be aware that that was enabled from the vendor that manufactured the board. Guess what? It is. And then I found credentials, and we can enable to do bad stuff. iBaby, this is one of two iBaby that we'll talk about. So this camera, one, has telnet enabled by default. Two, has a login of admin, which is root because there is only one account on this device, period. So it's not effectively root. It is basically their root based on privilege level. And something to point out. So Unixcrypt, or otherwise known as Devscrypt, if you ever see a password file, and I don't mean a shadow file, I mean actually Etsy password, which is indicator number one, thing about to go horribly wrong. If you see a hash that looks like this small and doesn't have a salt at the start and any of the stuff you're used to seeing in like a shadow file, it's probably because it's Unixcrypt. And Unixcrypt has been out of style for like over 15 years. Like, you should not see this anywhere being used, okay? Then you look deeper and you start seeing this. This is, now granted, this is a slightly older device. Like, this was like a 2013 device, maybe 2014. But you're seeing U-Boot, which is the bootloader again from 2005. OpenSSL from 2007, which is so old, it wasn't even affected by Heartbleed. So there's actually a feature of security there. You've got a Linux kernel that, I mean, like literally like hundreds of local kernel exploits have probably been written for that version of that kernel, or upstream, obviously, by that from that time to now. And a BusyBox from 08. You've got Telnet enabled by default. You've got Unixcrypt for password protection. Again, this is modern IoT $200 device that you buy from major retailers. iBaby is one of, arguably the number one IoT baby monitor on the market. And I sincerely mean that because like their iBaby M6, which we'll talk about in a second, is literally the number one selling Amazon camera for IoT baby monitors. And this camera, before the new one came out, was, I think, the number one. So this is the most up-to-date firmware they have. This is what, you know, this is what you can do today with this camera, is run this software, right? And if you saw this on a server, if you saw this on a laptop you owned, you'd be like appalled. You'd be like, oh my God, we got to get this off the network. It's like a danger. The problem is, whether this is in your home, or let's say your home, like if you work from home, for instance, you VPN in, or you have cloud services you use, these devices are like a pen tester's dream, right? Like, if you know, or an actual criminal's dream, because you have a device that has no visibility, no AV, whatever, no endpoint protection software, no host-based firewalls. You don't have any idea what or who is in this device. And so I, as an attacker, if I can find Telnet and I'm like, oh, Telnet's enabled, like root, root 123, root admin. Oh, I'm in. And now I have a administrative shell on a Linux server in your network. Like, if there's any pen testers in here, like that's game over, right? Like, you're like, okay, cool. I'm gonna upload tools, cross compile some stuff, and now I'm gonna own the rest of this network. This was the only camera that actually had, and there's two versions of this. You have data at rest for video and audio, and you have data in flight for video and audio. So this camera only did in-flight video and audio, and it actually encrypted it. It was the only camera that encrypted all video and audio in some, you know, mechanism going over the wire. The only camera. Now, it's encrypting it with a cipher called XXT. If any of you maybe did some like Xbox hacking back in the day, you might actually know what XXT is. The majority of you, you're like, oh, like I know RC4 and I know AES and I know RSA and blah, 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 right? Then there's a reason for that. There's a reason you don't know this cipher. It has known plain text attacks against it. It's not really, you're not gonna see it in a NIST standard anytime soon. It's there, it's not the worst thing in the world, but it's also not something that you would expect to see anywhere. And one of the reasons why is it's very low overhead. And that's why in an embedded device like this, one of the reasons we don't see a lot of SSL and TLS, and I've talked to vendors, I've done research, talked to vendors and been like, why don't you have SSL? Why don't you have TLS? The hardware's not powerful enough to do it live. 2013, 2014, 2015, we're still buying hardware from vendors at $200 price points that literally cannot do crypto real time to stream video and audio. So it's a very interesting time, and the reason that you can buy them for $200 versus $210 is literally that you don't get crypto. But they're willing to sell that to you. So we have an example on the top screenshot where There is a backup mechanism for like config file details, like passwords and all that good stuff, which is cool. And then it encrypts it with AES. So we're like, cool, encrypted backup, good idea, great idea, whatever. And then it hard codes this really crappy password for every single backup from every single camera, right? So that little CP to whatever, that is the hard-coded passphrase for every backup. So if for some reason these backups got leaked or you centralized them or they got exposed to Google for some reason, you literally can just download them, throw it through OpenSSL, and then decrypt it with that passphrase. So great to see crypto. Again, reverse engineering mobile apps can lead to a lot of fun information you would not otherwise have. All right, so IBM 6, we're starting to ramp up from the not, or maybe from the funny to the not funny, or vice versa, depending on what you think of things. So IBM 6, number one selling camera on Amazon for IoT baby monitors. Back-end web service that I think is no longer working at all. Back-end web service, completely unencrypted authentication. Mobile API calls for registration, passing passwords, passing session keys, everything all unencrypted from the mobile app. Default credentials on Telnet listening by default. Number one selling camera on Amazon, $200 camera. So a while ago, and I honestly don't go here that often, so maybe it works again, I have no idea. But while I was doing testing, that write screenshot was not happening. And then at some point later when I was building this deck, that started happening. And basically it's just like a stack trace from this code, and there's like a missing like hash function or something weird. What you need to know about that is it's good that that site's broken, because before it was broken, there was this web interface, and you could log in with your credentials as, you know, the owner of a camera. Subtle detail that might be really hard to see. So the back screenshot where it says proper account, the logged in account is mark.stanislav@gmail.com. The attacker account in the other screenshot is mark.stanislav@gmail.com. If you're not familiar with like Gmail and pretty much every other mail server out there, if you have a period, it does not actually impact the account. You can send whatever you want, and it just strips the periods out. Okay, so you can do, or like things like Mark Stanislav plus one, plus two, plus foo, plus bar, and it'll do the same thing. It all delivers the exact same account. So what's great about that is a lot of people I talk to, they're like, oh, I have like 300 email testing accounts. Why? You need one account and just append some crap on the end of it. You have unique accounts every time. So the proper account and the attacker account look a lot alike, and they go to the same mailbox, but in terms of the accounts themselves, they are completely separate accounts, completely different privileges, completely different views, because it's the account with the service provider. So TLDR on that is, you look at the back screenshot, you look at the front screenshot, and the problem here is that that string up there where it says CAMID/4106, whatever, you know, if you guys remember the Weave case and the AT&T stuff, this is what we affectionately refer to as direct object reference. You have an object ID, whether it's a serial number in this case or an integer for a database row or something, a table row, and you pull one out, put one in, and you get a different thing. You get the different object. So I, as my attacker account, log into an account that has no monitors attached. It's just a blank account. I change the URL to that camera, and now I'm seeing that camera's information, right? So I'm directly accessing another person's information. And you're like, okay, cool, like there's a camera ID, which we already knew clearly, a MAC address, which might be useful, some peer-to-peer UID, which God only knows what that does. You're like, okay, cool, I see some info, but nothing really like interesting. There's an alert information page. And you see these screenshots, and the screenshots are broke, and you're like, oh, like, if you're like me, you're like, oh, it's broke, it doesn't matter, no big deal, like, this is worthless. What I realized pretty quickly, though, were like those created dates and my testing timeline was actually the same. I was like, oh, wait, maybe those are my alerts. Maybe those are actually from me testing. And then I looked at my mobile app, which of course has a view of this data, and it's like, yeah, those are actual alerts that my mobile app knows about. So this is good data. You know, for some reason the website's broken, it's not showing screenshots. I was like, okay, that's a bit of a misnomer. You look at the source code, you look at the HTML, and each of these linked, or each of these images are actually linked, and the link has an AVI file name. So you go through the API calls being done by the mobile app when you like actually click on like view alert, and you see this happen. And you're like, okay, cool, some JSON information, blah, blah, blah. You're like, oh, cool, S3 key, which is a weird name, but beyond that. And there's a CloudFront URL. CloudFront is basically a caching engine for Amazon Web Services, like CDN functionality, basically. And so it's backed by an S3 bucket. You've got alert/the serial number of my camera. Okay, that's interesting. And then there's an AVI file name. and you go, okay, well, that's what a normal alert looks like. What happens if I go to this direct object reference web page, look at the HTML, grab the AVI file names, and append them? Well, you would get the files. You get the literal files. These files are not encrypted before upload. The URLs actually, even though that one is SSL, by default, these are not using SSL at all. So if you're on a public network, that video and audio is being transmitted clear text anyways. So the leap of faith you need to take with me here is, we know a serial number. Like, we know my serial number for my camera. The beautiful part about a serial number is it's serial. It goes up and it goes down, right? So you take some starting point, you work backwards and forwards, you make a for loop, you hit all these HTML pages for all these direct object references, you harvest anything with an AVI file name extension, you append the serial number for the right camera in the middle of that string, you append the AVI file name, and all of a sudden you have downloaded every single video for every single camera for every single user. And why this is important is because, unlike, let's just, you know, play devil's advocate for a second, unlike a camera where maybe you like access it remotely and you see like a live stream, the reason these videos exist in the first place is because there was either a motion alert or there was a noise alert. So someone is either in the room or someone talking in the room or near the room, right? Those are the two reasons this happens. So every single video you steal from every single person's camera is pretty much 100% guaranteed to have someone in frame or talking in frame, if you will. So in terms of a cache of like private moments and conversations and people being around, like, it's like 100% hit rate, which for an attacker is a really big deal. For extortion, for whatever, harassment, all the reasons people are terrible, fucking horrible people. This is a great example where you as an owner may not even realize that these videos are being created, right? You may have created, you may have downloaded the software, put it on your phone, set up your baby monitor's just on, you check it like once or twice, you know, a night or something. You don't go to recordings, you don't delete old videos, you're not doing that. That's time, who cares? It's just on there, it's in the cloud, big deal. And all of a sudden, like, I could very easily, you know, imagine reality where there are hundreds of thousands of videos from people's cameras that they never even realized are there. They're just in a different pane on a mobile app, right? And one thing that I ran into with another camera I did research on a couple of years ago, and I didn't actually test it for this, and I probably should have, but I had a camera that actually did the same kind of functionality. It recorded a video clip. You could go on the mobile app and delete it and view it or whatever. And what I found out is when I delete it out of the mobile app and I saved the URL, I think it was like, I don't know, I'd have to look at my screenshots. It was like 6 months later, I went, put in the URL in Google or in my browser, and that video file was still there. I had deleted it. I had swiped, I hit delete, and it was still there. And so when you have a situation like this, you never know what the data is doing, because again, you're trusting the mobile app. If the mobile app said you deleted it, right? Like, what would, you know, what else would happen? And so there's a huge data retention problem right now with IoT, because very few of these vendors are actually doing checks and balances to make sure that there's success on API calls, that there's an audit trail to say deleted file and then do a reconciliation to audit record. That stuff's not happening. We're not at a mature point where companies are thinking about doing that kind of stuff. And weirdly, just like an aside for some of you that might do, like, you know, again, pen testing or like OSINT operations, in terms of bad things that can happen, you've got a private wiki page, which, who knows what the password is, but probably not good. And then if you don't want to do like direct object vulnerabilities, there's literally an admin panel for this entire site just at /admin. And, you know, again, whether you fish credentials, brute force credentials, go to howibeenpwned.com and find their credentials, you know, having an admin site exposed like that on the internet's probably not the best thing when it has all the people's data for all these cameras. So that's kind of a good example of stored data, data at rest, and the insecurity around that data, and then retention and blah, blah, blah. Philips, which I have to say that Philips was an amazing company to work with. We've got some really good contacts in there with their team, and good, you know, bad scenario that we're about to talk to, but great response. So the camera I was talking about a few minutes ago is actually this camera on the left. And when I started doing research, I got onto this device. I'm like, man, some of these API calls look really familiar going to the wire. And it's because it's the same firmware. These are completely different screenshots. You can see some from the version details. But this is the same firmware because the manufacturer of the chipset is the one that provides the firmware. And then they plop their stuff on top of it, which happens a lot. And so I'm wondering, like, oh, are these all, you know, these issues that I got fixed by this other vendor years ago, did they ever get upstream to this actual manufacturer company? And the answer is no. This MG3500 account, the password on its Merlin in 2015 on a camera from Philips, it was MG3500 password of Merlin 2012 or 2013 on the Izon. So same firmware, same backdoor credentials, no SSL, same HTTP endpoints. Telnet was enabled until very recently. Like, I actually had the camera, tested it, I got a firmware update and it disabled Telnet. So a very recent change in that regard. Firmware upgrade process, going over the wire clear text, and then there's an MD5 sum, which is great. Good to use an MD5 sum for, you know, verification. Unfortunately, that's also going over unencrypted, so you can just change the MD5 sum to match your malware implanted firmware, because you control the wire. And so you've got all these bad things going on, but it gets a lot better. One reason is, A, there's a root password that's hard coded. The model number is literally B120. The password is B120 root. Okay, not a huge leap of the imagination for that one. So you've got a default root password, but Telnet's disabled. Good, Telnet's disabled, no big deal. There's actually a script that they created solely for the purpose of turning Telnet on. So that cam_service_enable.cgi, if you look at it, it's just a bash script. All it does is just enable Telnet. Okay, so you're like, okay, well, we can enable Telnet, but we can't enable Telnet because that web page, that CGI script, if you will, is password protected. And we don't know the password to get into the thing to do the thing. So we're stuck still. Well, you reverse enter into the mobile app. And in the mobile app, you see that it does a generate cam password. And how it's generating the password is it's taking the param string, and you go, well, what's the param string? Like, what's coming into this method? It's the MAC address of the camera. So you take a MAC address in, you MD5 sum it, you truncate it to 10 characters. That is the admin password for the camera's web service. Luckily, right, like, MAC addresses are hidden. You can't figure out a MAC address. There's no such thing as ARP cache, right? So literally, if you know one of these cameras are on the network with you, you ARP-A, you enumerate all the possibilities through this, like, very simple method. You hit this thing, and when you get a 200 response, guess what? You found the right one. Or if you are really lazy and really interested in just trying it long ways, as a lot of you probably know, like, MAC addresses have a thing at the start, the OUI, which is like the vendor of the network chipset. So you know the vendor of the network chipset, and then you just enumerate the entire key space for the end of it, and one of those will be the right passwords in that method. So we went from Telnet's disabled, great, to Telnet's disabled, but I have a web interface that I can enable Telnet, and I have the password for it, and once Telnet's enabled, I have the root password. So you just completely went from, like, nothing to everything in just a couple, like, quick steps, right? So now you have remote root shell via Telnet again. The one in the bottom corner, I was talking about this with a lot of glee at GERCON because I'm still excited about it, is honestly, you know, there's two total screenshots of cross-site scripting in this, one because it's a cloud service that we'll talk about in a second, and this one because it's a cloud service. And the reason I show it isn't because, oh, it's a cross-site scripting on a cloud service. It's because when I first did the research, I wasn't paying attention. And when you're looking at 9 devices at one time and all the mobile components and all the whatever, you kind of just skip things. You're like, okay, cross-site scripting, got it, cool. Like, over this pile of boring shit that I don't care about. And it wasn't until later when I came back to this vulnerability that I looked and I'm like, oh, you know what? I screwed up. It was a cross-site scripting vulnerability, but it wasn't reflective. It was actually stored. And why that's important is that Weaved is a IoT cloud platform. So it's not like it's this one camera with this, like, random service. Weaved is an entire platform that powers many, many, many platforms of IoT devices and many devices inside of that group. This one device was my test device, sure, but it's a way bigger service than just, like, this one camera, this one device in my house. The stored cross-site scripting is a big deal because once you can do stored cross-site scripting, the cookies on the entire site were not HTTP only, which we talked about earlier, which means that I can use JavaScript to read cookie data. So if you combine data that I can input that may or may not may be viewed by an admin at some point in time, guess what happens? It sends me their admin session cookie. and now I can log in as an admin for an entire IoT cloud platform. I'm not hacking my one device, I'm not hacking Philips, I'm taking over an entire IoT cloud platform with one cross-site scripting vulnerability. So when we're talking about IoT and the bad things that happen in supply chain, that's an awesome example where you could make the most like hardcore secure device in the world, and then you outsource some part of the service to a third party that has one cross-site scripting vulnerability and no HTTP only on session cookies, and now I've taken over all your devices and a lot more. Lesson learned, I will not treat cross-site scripting as a second-class citizen without at least verifying it first. Better than that, to varying degrees of better, the biggest vulnerability really with this, so it's not the backdoor password, it's not enabling telnet, it's not, you know, whatever. The problem with this, and I knew how all this worked because I had done this same camera before, right? Like I knew the firmware, I knew the service provider, I knew this entire chain back and forth. The thing that I'm really glad I tested, and that's the one thing that I think if any of you are getting into this stuff, no matter how many times you see a scenario, like the cross-site scripting thing that I just told you about that I'm an idiot for, never look at a scenario and go like, oh, I know how this works. Never do that. You have to test every single thing every single time, because as soon as you do that, you're gonna miss something really, really important. And what I would have missed here is that what this camera does is the camera sits behind your home network, which is on the internet, which then talks to your phone. The question is, in IoT, how does your mobile device talk to a device behind your home network? There's three ways this really is gonna happen. One is port forwarding. We're kind of past the age of port forwarding. Very few times will you ever actually go into your home router and port forward anymore. It's just not how we do things. Two is UPnP. UPnP is pretty alive and well. It'll negotiate and expose your device for you on the internet and do all the hard work for you. You don't have to do anything. We're starting to see that phased out a little bit, but it's still pretty alive and well. And then three is reverse proxy. So in this case, and this is how this one works, the camera runs an agent. There's a cloud service in the middle. The camera talks to the cloud service. The cloud service will actually map a public port, public host name, that is the entire web server of the camera. And that web server will now sit on the internet. And your mobile app will actually talk to that web server on your camera behind your firewall using this proxy as the means to get inside your home. So you might have thought like, I'm doing awesome network security, I'm blocking everything, I'm locking everything down, and guess what? These jerks put an entire web server on the internet that's behind your home network's firewall, and you have no idea it's probably been there. Where this falls apart is, aside from some obvious things like it's all clear text, which is not great, where this falls apart is that the actual access to this camera, you could do it via like source IP filtering. Once you establish the camera, you could do it via tokens, OAuth, passwords, crypto. You can do a lot of ways to authenticate communication, right? This camera was supposed to do source IP based filtering. So when you make the actual inbound connection the first time and actually ask to see the camera, it goes like, oh, I'm talking to you at this IP. I will only talk to you at this IP for the duration of this conversation. This device did not do that. And that was a bug, and a very costly bug. Because what it means is that if you can find one of these cameras on the internet, you are talking directly to that web server, and you're doing so completely authenticated without even a credential. So the whole like MAC address, MD5 sum truncation thing, you don't even need that. When you see this camera on the internet, you are logged in as admin by default just to talk to it. It's all there for you. So there's no authentication, it's on the internet, it's all clear text, and literally if you look at the VLC screenshot, if you type that URL in /temp/stream2/stream M3U8 for the playlist, that will actually open up the video stream of this camera unauthenticated on the internet. Now the question is, okay, so we know this has a vulnerability, practically, what does that mean? If you see at the start of the screen where it says http://, you'll see that says proxy9.uix.net. Well, guess what? The numbers are not an accident. There are ones that you can just do a NS lookup on and you can find proxy 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever. So we have a finite number of proxy hosts, all right? And then if you start doing some traffic analysis, you can kind of see the ports start roughly 30,000 and above. Good news is we're in the future. And in the future, we can scan the internet really fucking fast. And not even with ZMAP or something crazy like David Adrian, who's actually a ZMAP developer, yeah, like just a bash script and forking it really well and enough, you know, bandwidth to do it, you can just scan 30,000 ports times like a dozen roughly proxy host names like every minute, right? And you can seriously just wait for someone to start viewing their camera remotely. It'll open up the port, you'll get a 200 response, and now you can enable telnet over the internet. You can watch the live stream with them. If you have a vulnerability in one of the web apps, because there's a whole web application behind this, just like I said earlier, this web server that's exposed has like dozens of CGI scripts. And if you find one bug in one of them to do code execution, you can now implant malware. You can set a beacon, you know, and tie it into Armitage or whatever, Cobalt Strike. You can do whatever you want at that point. And then what happens is it establishes a connection back to you, and it's always open, and always listen, and it's always sending communications. So even when they're done viewing their camera and this connection closes and this port closes, well, guess what? You're still connected to them. So now you have an internet connection through this camera via a simple failure to check an IP address. Very, very quickly cascades into a bad problem. And of course, if you wanted to test as I did, this is a channel that we're in for work. I popped in the URL to my camera at that moment and asked someone to click on it, and they got the, you know, mobilized camera service enabled. So they enabled Telnet remotely just by clicking a URL in a Skype channel. And that's, I mean, those two screenshots are like the most reality I can show you today, which is once the camera's on the internet, it's like all you know, all bets are lost. That's awesome. That's a great intro for this slide especially. Chris and Charlie would probably appreciate that. So I have this as my tweet that you probably can't read up there explains. You know, when you're on a Windows box and you're doing code execution, like the de facto is like pop, you know, up calc.exe and be like, oh look, I have code execution calc.exe. My contention is that on the heels of their Jeep security research, where they displayed themselves in tracksuits on the console for Andy Greenberg, my contention is that any visual compromise should require them in tracksuits as the way you show that. So the thing is, you know, we see a lot of bad TV shows. Maybe this was part of the plot in CSI Cyber. I have no idea. But we've seen a lot of bad TV shows where like a criminal or a good guy takes over like a camera network and they, you know, take 30 seconds of video and then loop it, you know, and they break in and they do something bad and they get out and they cut off the video loop. Yeah, you can totally do that. Like, you can totally put whatever the hell you want on people's mobile apps, because again, they're trusting what's coming from the camera. There's no integrity check. There's no, you know, like weird crypto. Like whatever you put in between them and the camera, or like in this example, I'm literally just taking a JPEG of that image and just in a while loop on the camera, just overwriting whatever temp file's there. Just every single like millisecond, it's just doing it. So whether you man in the middle of the connection, because again, this is all like pretty much not encrypted, and you just man in the middle of everything, or you just overwrite the files on the file system when you have access, you know, you can take over and do whatever you want. All right, so we have data at rest, taking all these video clips, really bad stuff. We have opportunistic, enable tunnel over the internet and view live video streams, so we're kind of working our way up. So the summer camera, and this is the camera my mother-in-law was about to buy. Couple things. One, Amir over at Optiv, he had actually done research that he presented at DEF CON 2 years ago now. What's funny is while I was doing this research, I didn't realize he had looked at this. And I was like, oh shit, did he like find all the bugs I'm about to report and this is dumb and whatever else. Turns out he found a lot of what I found, because even though this happened like a year before my research, they never fixed any of this stuff. So there was some stuff that I was like, oh, you found it first, no big deal, you've already published it. So I just got rid of that out of. But I wanted to give him a shout out to the research he did. A lot of backdoor credentials and some other funny stuff that we both found at different times. One thing, and this is a really good user experience thing, and I don't think as security professionals we really think about user experience security bugs enough. And this is one where when you initialize your camera and you say sign up my camera and sign up my account, this is my email address. This vendor will actually send you an email with your password in it. Now, I'm not, like, the last thing I'm gonna get up here and talk about is like, oh, unencrypted passwords in email. Yeah, it's dumb, it's not a good idea, great, I don't care. What's important though is the password itself and how it's generated is it's your last name truncated to 8 characters and the group identifier, which is effectively the serial number for your account in their database. Why is that a problem? Well, if you know someone that has a camera and you're like 99% of the people on earth not in this room right now, you're gonna get an email like this. And you're gonna take that username, take that password, and you're gonna write down that password on your post-it note or your password manager, God forbid, and it's going to sit there because 9 out of 10 people are going to look at that password and be like, that's a secure password. Because what have we taught people? It's got to be long. It's got to have mixed case. It's got to have numbers. That's a good password, right? It's a good password. My mom would totally keep that password around forever. Why would she change it? Because it fits all the rules that we've told people. Because people think like, oh, that's a random number. You know, it's not a random number. It's completely not a random number. And I know what the random number is because I have one of these cameras, and just like before, you can enumerate backwards and forwards and you get the entire key space. So if you know someone that has this camera and you know their last name, assumably, you can truncate their last name to 8 characters, you can start at a number that you know about, work your way back and forward, and you're pretty much guaranteed to log into their account. So user experience vulnerability, it's not obvious, but when you're thinking about things in terms of like holistic security, this is the kind of thing that you should be, you know, telling your vendors, like, this is a bug, you should not do this, and here's the reason why. Because the reality is, they're not gonna sell 100,000 cameras. They're gonna sell like 20,000 cameras, right? There's not that many numbers to go through. It's a very small range to actually brute force on the internet. This is, and I say this every single time, I'm gonna keep saying it, this is the most interesting slide you will ever see for a vulnerability, and that's for a very good reason, because the vulnerability is terrible. And it's terrible because the first screenshot is just my admin console. This is like normal day-to-day. You log into a web service, you see some details, you see user accounts. And what this interface lets you do is, like, my brother who lives in Arizona, if I want to give him temporary control of my camera so he can see his niece, I can do that. And he can log in with his credential, his mobile app, and then see the camera. Very, very useful feature. Problem is, the entire website, as far as I looked, the entire website authenticates every single thing based on a session value, which is completely fine to do, like session handling, right? What this single page, the single curl action, the single get parameter or setup get parameters doesn't do is authentication. And so you have register slash a first name, a last name, an email address, a user type, which is like a privilege level, and then that awesome like super secure group ID number. And that's it. No cookie, no session, no token, no password, no username, nothing. That's it. So again, kind of like our first example, you go from one number to the next number, you do a for loop, you add yourself as an admin to every single camera for every single user of the service. $200 camera, Summer is like one of the biggest brands in the US for baby stuff altogether. They have like a dozen cameras at Target alone, various types of cameras, but like a dozen cameras at Target alone, selling Babies R Us and Best Buy and all this other stuff. This camera, one curl command, copy and paste that into your browser and change the number one up, one down. You are adding yourself full administrative privilege to not only go pull up your mobile phone, log in with credentials you now have, because guess what? They email you the credentials, which we already kind of knew about. But you can actually still control the camera too. So you not only can like have viewing access, but you have full control too. So every single camera from this one vendor with a simple for loop, you have full access to. And again, this is one of those things that no one's gonna get a red flag. They're not gonna get an email that says like, congratulations, you added someone to your account. Nope, you just get an access. You get an email that says, congratulations, you have access, but no one knows you have access. And what you could do if you're really clever is, now that you have admin access, you can create two accounts or one account or whatever, log in, do whatever you're gonna do, delete your account. Because guess what? You can add your account anytime you want. So you don't even have to leave a trail. You can just create an account, abuse it, delete the account, create an account, abuse it, delete the account. So again, lots of backdoor credentials, lots of like ugly, stupid stuff that we saw, but we have full takeover of all videos recorded. We have opportunistic access to do code execution, web apps, viewing streams. And then we have just full unfettered camera admin access, right? Three different vendors, three different cameras, three different supply chains, three different price points. And you know, again, pretty critical bugs, right? Because if you wanna do one thing with a baby monitor, it's not have people look at your baby monitor, right? And that's exactly what these three things let you do, is look at the baby monitor. So we dropped these bugs on these vendors on July 4th, only not because we're complete assholes, but because we ran out of some time and I had to get it by this date, because we always do 60-day disclosure timelines at Rapid7. We're really serious about that, so we kind of had to push it in there, unfortunately, on the holiday. Sorry, guys. And then we always follow up with cert, So cert will also kind of like coordinate bug disclosure, work with vendors more directly, and be kind of a good third-party steward to get the stuff fixed. Overall, so you've got a kind of a good chart of where all these things went wrong. And by no means is this like a complete view of the things you should look for a device in terms of security, but a good list of them. So local and cloud APIs, where are they encrypted? Remote shell, so do they have SSH or telnet by default? Hidden accounts, if you notice that every single camera had at least one account that you as a consumer do not know is there. Every single camera had at least one account. Many of them had multiple accounts. Vulnerabilities, and I'm only talking like good vulnerabilities, like ones we talked about today. I'm not talking about vulnerabilities in the sake of like, oh, there's cross-site scripting, or there's like on a back-end web interface, or like a CSERF on a back-end web interface. All these cameras had some sort of bug. They just weren't a big enough vulnerability for me to even like waste time on. UART, every single camera had UART, and then encryption we talked about, only one of the devices is streaming all the video and audio that it's passing through. So then I like to play like apples to oranges games with computer stuff. So I gave every camera 250 points. That's just where they start. And then I gave some rough scoring based on criteria and kind of impact, and then deducted them from each of the cameras. We can argue about points all day because I argue with it myself still to this day. But what we end up with, and I think this is a pretty fair assessment if you aren't on the same page yet with me, we got 8 Fs and 1 D. So I just took all the point scales, applied a normal school grade scale, and ended up with, you know, grades. And so you can see the point totals themselves. So the iBaby M6, number one camera sold on Amazon today for IoT baby monitors, 0 points for security. The only camera that got a D, the iBaby M3S, again, as you saw from the software versions on that camera, don't let the grade alone fool you. Like, we can tell, like, cameras that ship 2005 software, it's not a good camera, it's not secure. But at least you have some apples to apples to work with. Overall, yes, there were some really big vulnerabilities. I think we've kind of hit that pretty hard. Simple things, like I said, cross-site scripting, CSERF. Back-end web apps, so things that are not internet exposed, there are a ton of vulnerabilities there as well. I was looking for a lot more, you know, huge impact, real life. This could actually be a problem for people's stuff. So number one, baby monitors are in a bad place right now. And again, most of consumer IoT, a lot of business IoT looks just like these cameras looked like. So we're in a bad place. Number two, even the best cameras for varying degrees of best, whether it's best price point or best feature set, all of them had, I think, enough issues that you can be kind of worried. Consumers have no idea any of this is happening. A lot of consumers probably would assume all this is encrypted. People would assume there aren't backdoor passwords. Reasonable assumptions, perhaps, but not reality. And then of the vendors I talked to, I think only Philips actually has what I'd consider a security program. So they actually have people that care about security on staff. Most of these vendors are outsourcing all this work. And a lot of it is white labeled completely. Like the Wi-Fi baby, is actually called YCam. Like, that's the generic name of it. You can buy a YCam. It's the exact same style, the exact same firmware. It's just branded and with baby in the name and charged like $60 more. Brilliant, right? So some good things. So Build Securely, like I mentioned, is an initiative I co-founded. What we do is we work by giving IoT security resources to vendors that want to do better at security. We also hook up vendors with researchers that we trust in the field, and they do some pro bono research. So instead of me buying a device when it goes to Amazon.com, we will actually get devices just before they go to production, try to break them then, get bugs fixed, and then have the vendor ship them. So we kind of flip the process on its head, make the consumers have a better experience, make the vendors have a better experience. It's all pro bono, all completely free. So we try to help in that regard. OWASP top 10, not just web. OWASP, despite their name, does a lot of other top 10 lists. They have an embedded hardware top 10 and some other cool stuff. And IoT top 10 is one of them that Daniel Miesler at HP has put together. Online Trust Alliance is in the second draft of an IoT trust framework. It's really cool. I'm one of the people involved in that process. And why it's cool is because why it's called trust framework is it addresses both privacy and information security. And if you think those are the same thing, talk to a privacy person. They will tell you it's not, without question. But why that's good is when I talk about things like data retention is not inherently an information security problem technically. There's implications to information security, certainly, but it's a privacy concern, number one. And that's why when we're doing when we're doing information security checklists, I guarantee you none of them are going to say, does this data get deleted after 30 days? You're not going to find a checklist for information security that says that for something like an IoT device. That's why the privacy people have to be involved. And so the trust framework addresses both InfoSec and privacy concerns, which is great. I wish everything did that. And then lastly, Google, the OnHub that just got released, is using Brillo, which is basically a stripped-down Android Android Linux that's made for IoT deployments. And then Weaved is actually a secure communication for inter-device communication protocol. So there are good things. This is a very short list of good things, but there are good things on the horizon. There are people working on problems like what we went over today. Literally this afternoon, I got an email from a vendor who is coming for the first time to market with a baby monitor. And they contacted Build Securely. They're just before production stage and they want to know if we can help. So I have a call with them this week to talk about that. So this is real life, like stuff getting fixed. Like we're not just like hand waving around, even though I hand wave a lot. This is actually like valuable stuff that's happening. And TLDR, of course, is like, until we fix stuff, stuff's gonna keep happening. So if you're tired of the news stories with like a baby getting yelled at or a nanny getting yelled at over the internet or RF or whatever, or if you're tired of people breaking into people's Bluetooth locks or whatever, like the biggest thing I can tell you is this kind of research, and hopefully you could tell from like the first couple of slides, this kind of research for most people is very simple. If you can hook up a couple wires, you can do this kind of research. If you can run Wireshark, you can do this kind of research. The stuff I presented to you today is not like a testament to me being good at like hacking. It's a testament to how bad IoT is, okay? So get on board, buy some $50 pieces of hardware at Best Buy, go on eBay and find some stuff that's used, and just buy stuff, pop it open, hook up some clips, do some Nmap scans and Wireshark dumps, and you can be giving a better talk than this next month, right? There's a lot of work out there. There are hundreds of thousands of IoT devices and not even a close amount of researchers to do it all. So if you're kind of like, oh, I don't know if I want to be a researcher. Yeah, you should be a researcher because you can fix stuff like this and that's cool. So that's my talk. I'm probably way over or something. I don't know. Who knows? What do you guys care? I got to drive back to Dearborn. Fuck you guys. Any questions I can answer for you guys? You were so quiet during that whole thing, so.
Where can we find your white paper?
That's a good question. It's probably some long URL at rapid7.com's website. I think it still might be on the splash page at the lower half of Rapid7. Worst case, there's my info. I will email you or tweet you back a direct link to it if you want it. And I have some business cards too if you're really bad at like writing stuff down or typing things on computers. But it goes over a little bit more of the vendor disclosure process as well, and like the responses we got or didn't get, and then the feedback and the conversation we have with vendors, and so some cool insight on that part. Because like a whole huge chunk of this work was just working with vendors, and if you haven't done research yet and actually talked to vendors about bugs, the research part's the simple part. Working with vendors and not having them sue you is the hard part. So it's kind of status quo for everything, though. Other questions?
This is probably a yes, but do you know anyone working on the home camera systems? The ones that you just plug in a box, plug in all the cameras.
Drop cam.
Well, not drop cam, but...
Like more like the surveillance style?
Yeah, the surveillance ones.
So fun fact. There was a talk that got pulled at Hack in the Box that was supposed to go out like last week or whenever Hack in the Box was. And he pulled it for threats from vendors. So there was a talk about it that was supposed to happen, and then it got pulled like a week ago. So maybe that research will come out. I know it's one of those topics that I've heard a lot of people will bring up, but other than that talk that hasn't happened yet, may not ever happen, I don't know of like a good, like a case study talk like this that looked up like at a bunch of vendors and looked at what the market looked like.
I've got one at home, but I haven't connected it because when I first did Nmap on it, I had a bunch of shit open. I was like, this can't be good.
Yeah, no, I mean, I said, like whether it's research or partners for Build Securely, or like I have actual clients at Rapid7 that are IoT vendors. Okay, so I talk to people from all different like views, and the number of terrible things you hear about is just like mind-numbing. Weird internet-facing UDP protocol like ports that are just on there to do like remote control for like a service provider that God only knows, like some like C binary. It's probably like a fuzzer's heaven, like. Just terrible things left to right, I'm sure. But telnet, SSH is enabled all the time. Web services are enabled all the time. Things are UPnP'd you don't know about. Just, you know, crazy exposure. And again, nothing, whether or not baby monitor or home surveillance camera, it's probably about the same.
Yeah.
So, anyone else? Cool. Well, thank you for your time today. I hope you enjoyed the talk. And if you have any other questions, feel free to say hello. Thanks.